Hello everyone, I am CS Aboli Pitre and welcome to fifth lecture of our lecture series on company law. Today we are going to discuss memorandum and articles of association. I have divided this topic in two parts because in today's video, that is the first part, we are going to discuss the basic concept as well as contents of memorandum and articles of association. And in second part, we will discuss some important doctrines which help us understand MOA and AOA further. So let's get started. To understand this concept, I want you to think about some group project that you must have done in your school or college, etc. When we have to do group project, we have to be really, really clear about two things. What is the group project about and how are we going to do this project? The work has to be divided amongst people and there has to be clarity about the role of each person. What are his responsibilities, what decisions he can take on behalf of all the group, etc., right? Now think of a company. Company is nothing but a huge group project. Because what is it? It's just group of people coming together to achieve some objective, right? However, in case of company, the number of people who are involved is sometimes even in thousands and lakhs. And therefore, what is the company? What objective it wishes to achieve and what role each of the member of this company, director of the company, is going to perform. It has to be crystal clear. It has to be well defined and of course in a written format. Therefore, we have memorandum of association and articles of association. When company has to get itself registered, these are the two documents which are mandatorily to be submitted to registrar of companies to get the incorporation certificate. MOA, that is Memorandum of Association, gives us the answer to the question, what? And AOA gives us the answer to the question of how. Means, the Memorandum of Association tells us what is the company, what are its objective, and anything and everything that you want to know about the company. On the other hand, Articles of Association tells us about how the company will function, how will the decisions be taken, what will be the liabilities, what will be the authorities of each of the member and directors of the company. Let's understand Memorandum of Association first. It is a document and Section 4 of Companies Act 2013 tells us what all to be included in the Memorandum of Association of Company. In this document, these all information must be written. First is name clause, obviously name of the company. Situation clause means where the registered office of the company will be situated. Then the object clause. In object clause, what is the objective of company? Object clause is the most important clause because anything done beyond the objective which is mentioned in MOA is considered to be invalid act. Then the liability clause. We have already seen company can be either unlimited company or limited by guarantee, limited by shares. So we have to mention type of company when it comes to liability. That has to be mentioned in liability clause and then of course the capital clause. What is the maximum amount of capital that the company can have is mentioned in this clause. Let's discuss each of this clause one by one. Let's start with understanding the name clause of the company. It is obvious that the memorandum of association must mention the name of the company. We can get our company registered under any name that we desire. However, there are some exceptions or restrictions. Those must be taken into consideration before we name our company in memorandum of association. They are, first and the most importantly, use of word limited or private limited after the name of the company. If your company is a public limited company, then the word limited must be added after the name. For example, ABC Company Limited. Or if the company is private limited, the words private limited should be added, like ABC Company Private Limited. So by mere reading of the name of the company, any person would get to know if company is a limited, that is private limited or public limited company. Then the name of the company should not be identical or resembling to any other company's name which is already registered under this act. Now this is very important and obvious because if any other company is already in existence and you are using the same name, any third party would get confused as to your company is in some shape or form is related to that company, and it is unfair to the other company because you are taking advantage of the name and brand value that they have already built. To understand this, let's take the example of a case law of 1917. So it was the case of Ewing versus Buttercup Margarine Company Limited. So Mr. Ewing was a person who was already doing the business of dairy, milk and milk products under the name of Buttercup Dairy Company Limited. And there was a new company incorporated afterwards, was Buttercup Margarine Company Limited. Now we know margarine is a produce which is used as a substitute to butter, just like a butter. So, and butter is a dairy product which Mr. Ewing was already producing. So it was very obvious that any person may get confused as to this new company is directly related to Mr. Ewing's Buttercup Dairy Company Limited. And he was doing this business for years together, so he had his own brand value in the market. So he went and filed for injunction, that is to stop this company from using this name, and it was very, very, very resembling to his name, that is Buttercup Dairy Company Limited. And he succeeded in his suit, and this company was stopped from using this name. So the company should not have a name which is identical or very resembling to other company's name. Then the third thing is, the name of the company should not be undesirable to the opinion of central government. Generally, the names which are very vulgar or which can create hatred amongst communities, such names are not allowed. Then the name of the company should not be such that it gives the impression of false patronage of government. Patronage of government means government funding is there or government is involved in the formation of company, etc. So if I tomorrow use the word India, for example, in my name of company, then the person may get a false impression that my company is a government company or has something to do with government. So things like that should not be there. And the name of the company should not be in contravention of any law. Now there are multiple laws which are already there protecting the brand names, or some there are certain laws which prohibit us from using certain words in the name. For example, Trademark Act. Under the Trademark Act, if the name of the company is protected, then any other person cannot use that name. But there is this act called Emblems and Names Prevention of Improper Use Act of 1950. In that act, certain words are given and those words cannot be used in the name of the company. So while naming the company, those all things must be taken into consideration, and then only the name clause of the memorandum of association should be drafted. Next clause is situation clause. Now every company must have a registered office. Why it is necessary? Because under whose jurisdiction the company falls is decided based on where his registered office is situated. So tomorrow if any suit is to be filed against company, or if any action is to be taken against the company for non-compliance, it will fall under the jurisdiction of court where the registered office of the company is registered, right? So there has to be a situation clause in memorandum of association which states that in which state of India the registered office of company is situated. So for example, the registered office of the company shall be situated in the state of Maharashtra, or in the state of Gujarat, or in the state of West Bengal, etc. The next important clause to be understood is the object clause. Object clause limits the activities of the company. It decides what a company can do, and anything which is done beyond this is beyond the power of the company and is held invalid. It cannot be given effect to in the eyes of law. Therefore, object clause is the most important clause of any company's memorandum of association. Why object clause is so necessary is for three reasons. These three reasons are these. Firstly, it protects the shareholders, the rights of the shareholder. So when the shareholder invests his money in company, he knows what are the activities for which the money will be used, and company has to abide by those activities only. It cannot use the money collected from shareholders for anything apart from what is written in the object clause. So shareholder is aware where his money is being used. Secondly, it also protects the creditor. So whatever money company is borrowing, creditor is aware that the money borrowed shall be used for these projects only. And if he thinks that yes, these projects are viable and profitable, and therefore I have the chances of getting my money back, then only he gives the loans. So what if the company is taking loan for one reason and using it for something else? That cannot happen, because again, the object clause limits the activities of company, and the company has to do activities mentioned here only. It also protects the interest of public at large, because we know as the company has to perform only a certain limited activity, it cannot go on expanding inorganically to such an extent that it results in concentration of economic power, which is not really good for public at large. And therefore, there are some checks and balances with the help of object clause of the company. And whenever company has to register itself, it has to tell it to government through object clause what activities it will perform and what are its limitations. To understand how object clause work, let's understand a case of one company named German Date Coffee Company. Now, when the company got itself registered, in the object clause it has mentioned that it has the objective of acquiring a patent of, you know, creating coffee-like substance from dates and then trading in that substance after manufacturing it, right? However, what happened is, after it got itself registered with this objective, it failed in acquiring that patent. So what they did, they acquired some other patent from Sweden. So they acquired some Swedish patent and started trading in that. So what happened? Two of the shareholders of the company went to court and challenged this action of the company by stating that when we invested the money of the company, we invested it because we read the objective of acquiring patent and manufacturing coffee from dates and trading in that. We did not agree for something else than this. So our money is being used for something that we did not agree to, right? We did not agree to this Swedish patent and trading in that. So it should not be considered as valid. And yes, court agreed with their contention and held, you cannot do anything which is beyond the object clause. Object clause limits the activities that any company can perform. And this act of company of acquiring Swedish patent and trading in that was considered to be invalid. Mind you, when the company writes its object clause, after that, yes, it can be altered, it can be changed. However, there is certain procedure to be followed. Without following that procedure, you cannot alter the memorandum and you cannot do anything which is not written in the memorandum. And therefore, this act was held invalid. Therefore, understand this, object clause of the company limits the activities of the company, and hence is the most important clause. The next important clause in MOA is capital clause. Capital clause means the maximum amount up to which the company can raise its capital. And it cannot be just an amount. It has to be mentioned very specifically, as in what will be the amount and it will be divided in how many shares of what value and what kind. For example, it can be the authorized capital of the company will be rupees 10 lakh divided into 1 lakh equity shares of rupees 10 each. It can also be a combination of two or more types of shares. For example, if I say that my capital will be rupees 10 lakh, it can also be like 50,000 equity shares of rupees 10 each and 50,000 preference shares of rupees 10 each. This is the face value of the shares, this is the type of the shares, and this is the number of the shares, and this will be the total amount. So this way the capital clause of the company has to be mentioned in memorandum of association. The next important clause is liability clause. Now, as we have already discussed, the company can be an unlimited company or a company limited by shares, limited by guarantee. This is to be mentioned in this clause. If the company is limited by guarantee, then it has to mention what will be the amount of guarantee given by each of the member. So by reading this clause, we will get to know what is the type of company based on its liability. After all of these clauses are mentioned, we have to see the subscription page. In that, the people who have subscribed to the memorandum of association. Now, who are the subscribers? The initial people who come together and form a company, the members of the people. Those are the subscribers. Now, we need minimum 2 members in case of private company, minimum 7 members in case of public company. Those people have to write their name and address, also the number of shares that they have subscribed to, and they have to sign. So these all things are mentioned at the end of the memorandum of association. Every subscriber must hold minimum 1 share, right? So these all things are mentioned at the end of the memorandum. In case of one person company, apart from all of these things, the memorandum should also mention the name of the nominee. The format in which the MOA has to be drafted is given in Schedule 1 of Companies Act 2013. And it gives us different tables from table A to table E. These are different, you know, formats depending on the type of the company. The formats has to be adapted. Now that we have understood memorandum of association, let's move to articles of association. Articles of association, that is AOA, is also another important document that must be filed with registrar of companies to get the company incorporated. Unlike memorandum of association, articles of association talks more about internal affairs of the company, internal management of the company. It is also called as bylaws or rule book of company, about how the activities of the company will be performed. Section 5 of Companies Act 2013 tells us about articles of association. What different things are mentioned in articles of association? Let's see. These are some of the contents of articles of association. It tells us about things such as adaptation of preliminary contracts, how to raise share capital, how to allot the shares, what will be the rights of members as well as proxies, how the directors should be appointed and their meetings to be conducted. It also gives us about power of company to issue the debentures, how the general meetings to be conducted, what will be the borrowing powers of company, how to decide the rate of dividend, how to maintain the accounts, how to conduct the audit. It also tells us about the procedure of winding up. Just like memorandum of association, we also have a separate format given for articles, that is given in Schedule 1, and from table F to table J, depending on the type of the company, it gives us the format of AOA. However, company, if want to add something more to whatever is given in this format, it can definitely do so. Section 5 also tells us about an interesting provision of entrenchment in articles of association. What is this provision of entrenchment? Is if there is some provision in articles of association which talks about very crucial business matters, if that provision has to be changed, then very strict rules and very strict procedures can be adapted by the company, which can be even stricter than having a special resolution, that is having 75% or more of the members approving that. So the provision can be strict, it can be taking consent of all the members, for example. So articles of association can have a provision which asks for a stricter procedure to be followed to alter the things which are very crucial to business, that is called as entrenchment provision. Now that we have already understood MOA and AOA of company, let's understand the relationship and dynamics between them. Section 6 of Companies Act tells us that neither MOA nor AOA can contravene Companies Act. It is obvious because Companies Act gives us the limits and rules within which the company has to perform. Abiding to these rules, only the memorandum and articles of association can be drafted. At the same time, it is to be understood that articles of association is always subordinate to memorandum of association. So, the supreme one is Companies Act 2013. So, this is the limit Companies Act has given to us. Within these limits, we can have MOA and AOA. However, articles of association is again subordinate to memorandum of association. So, the maximum limit is given by Companies Act. Within that, memorandum of association can be drafted and its limits can be specified. And articles of association is even subordinate to memorandum of association. So, it cannot have anything in contravention to MOA and Companies Act. At the same time, memorandum of association cannot have anything which is in contravention of Companies Act. Let's take the example of number of directors. The Companies Act tells us that public company needs to have minimum 3 directors. Now, I am a public company. In my articles of association, I cannot state that my company shall have only 2 directors because it is in contravention of Companies Act, and because my AOA as well as MOA is subordinate to Companies Act, I cannot do so. At the same time, however, I can state that my company shall have minimum 4 directors because then I am already complying with this requirement of 3 directors, and I am even making it stricter. That is allowed. However, I cannot have any terms and conditions which are in contravention of Companies Act. The next thing to be understood is how binding is memorandum and articles of association of company. Is it binding on company? Is it binding on members? And who becomes liable by whatever is written in those documents? We need to understand that when the MOA is drafted, it is signed by the subscribers who are the members of the company, and it is just like any other contract. So it has the same effect as if the contract has been signed between members and the company. Why I am saying so? When two parties sign the contract, both are bound by whatever is written in the contract and both are liable to each other, right? The same is applicable in case here. Whatever is written in MOA, the company is liable to its members by it. At the same time, the members are liable to company by it. So if any liability is on members, for example, the liability clause in memorandum. So yes, the member are liable to company to pay that much amount which is mentioned in the liability clause. At the same time, certain rights are given to the members by articles by the company, then yes, company is bound to give those rights to those members. It is just like a contract between them. However, it does not give any right to one member against another member. So, yes, it creates the liability of members towards a company and company towards members. However, it does not create any liability of one member against another member. At the same time, it does not bind any third party because the third party is outsider, right? So, it only binds company and its members. I hope the concept of memorandum and articles of association is clear to you. If yes, then don't forget to like and share this video with your friends. Also, if you have any doubt, anything to say to me, go ahead and comment below this video. And please, please, please subscribe so that you don't miss on any video. And it helps me a lot. It gives me encouragement to keep doing these videos. And we will discuss the doctrines which are related to memorandum and articles in next video. I will see you then. Take care. Goodbye.